Namaste.
Namaste and welcome back to RaGa Candid on yet another Monday.
Every time we sing a snippet of the song, we get the same request, please finish the song. And I guess one of the earlier episodes, we had sung Raga Sudarasa in Andolika, but only a portion of the song. So we will
sing this the first entirety now.
Yeah.
Oh, manasa,
Sudha
Rasa Rasa.
Sadashiva Maya Magu Nadokara Swara.
Sadashiva Maya Magu
Nadokara
Swara.
Sadashiva Maya Magu Shiva Maya Magu Nadonkara Swara. Vidulo Jeevan Mukto Laritya Raju Teliyu. Vidulo Jeevan Mukto Laritya Raju Teliyu. So as the words go, Raga Sudha Rasa Panamu, drink this nectar of the music.
This music is a result, or it's equal to yaga, yoga, bhoga. It's equal to ritual, sacrifice, penance, yoga. It has the beneficial fruit of all this.
It's and it gives us ananda, bliss.
Bliss. Such a beautiful, beautiful words, meaning, and of course, a matchless composition in Raga Andolika. By Sadhguru Tyagaraja Swami. It brings us to a very beautiful, meaningful question that we received in one of the comments on the earlier episodes, which was, why classical music?
Why classical music, and how does classical music help you through life?
Yes. So it's, of course, it's not easy to answer it, because when we heard the question, I said, why classical music? Because, you know, when you get into it too early in life, you don't learn to ask these questions, and it becomes so integral a part of your life that we don't really remember ever having asked this question.
Yes.
But when we traveled as part of, you know, leg dems in many
presenting
schools
and classical music across, yes, schools and colleges,
which we have done, this was the question that we always came up: why classical music? What's so great about it? Why is it so difficult to understand it, and why should I even bother? When there is so much of options that give you easy satisfaction, makes you dance and groove, and you can consume it like so many lollipops and golgappas, why classical music? Why make the effort? It's a very beautiful question, and yeah, let's try to answer that.
Yes, first, this to succeed in anything, don't you have to have a little bit focus? Any high achiever would tell you that they have this inordinate ability to focus, to go into the depth of a problem and solve it.
Correct.
So classical music is an easy way to introduce that discipline in life.
Very true. I mean, even just look at the beginner level classes. You don't, you know, when you hear a piece of popular music, it's so easy to sing and hum along. But what, you don't learn easy songs in a classical music class. You are taught to sit down in a cross-leg position, which itself is a bit of a struggle. And then you learn to listen to the tanpura. That's the first thing that you're asked. That's a tanpura. And the tanpura will give you the tonic, the basic note. And then you learn to say sa. Only one note, it takes a life out of you many times.
Yes. And a friend of ours who is very close to us, the scientist, remember he told us that he had done a lot of research on the effect of music on the human being. And Indian classical music actually charges up the maximum part of the brain.
Yeah, and even as a beginner level, you have to do a number of things to be able to learn classical music. One is to tune your mind to the Shruti.
Even the very act of, you know, singing a composition which you have learned, and just to, you know, reproduce that composition itself, you need to do so many things at the same time. You have to actually multitask, right? You are in a position, your posture is right. Then you have to remember that a composition, of course, is in a raga. Then you have to remember the way the raga goes, the melody of that raga. Then you have to put tala while you are singing that composition, which means you have to be aware of that as well. And then, of course, the lyrics.
The memory is also charged. Because
you have to remember the lyrics. You have to remember the tune of the composition. Then you have to remember the sankatis, the different sankatis and the sequence of those sankatis. You have to remember. And then you have to be able to sing for 5 minutes or more. Then it means you have to have a lot of stamina. Then you have to do a lot of deep breathing for that to happen, which is also very good for you. Then, of course, it will help if you know the meaning of those lyrics, which will help you in rendering the compositions better. So, you know, imagine just singing a composition that you've learned and rendering it. So many things work in tandem.
Correct. And when we go to a slightly advanced level, when you are singing Manodharma or creatively engaging in music, it is a combination of what you have already learned to do through your memory, through your understanding. And then you are also bringing your own creative energies. So this is a very beautiful way in which all parts of the brain come together. Mm-hmm. And of course, things like dynamics, like letting the co-artist's music also flow with yours. It is not that they're just playing for you. It's a very, very...
dynamic thing.
Yeah, they're not merely accompanying you. You are listening to them actively and you are actually calibrating your music, or actively the music acquires a certain structure because of the way different artists come together or interpret it on that particular day. So classical music at so many levels, at the physical level, at the mental level, at the emotional level, it challenges you. It draws, it demands a certain ardor, discipline out of you. And that is only from the perspective of being a musician. Now from the perspective of a listener, how does classical music make you feel better, or why is it better than other kinds of music?
Yes, the very act of listening, you have to be so deeply engaged in so many things. You have to be engaged with the music to be able to appreciate.
Yeah, certainly, it's not a listening that can be done casually, or it is mindful listening is very much a part of engaging with classical music.
That is why we say, no, that even for a listener, you should have a Saraswati in you to be able to appreciate classical music.
What does that really mean? It doesn't mean that we carry an idol of Saraswati in our pockets. It only means that we have the ability to open our mind, to broaden our vision and focus on something so intensely. That is the spirit of Saraswati after all.
Yes. And you learn.
Yes.
Open your mind and learn so many nuances.
And I mean, even listeners, I mean, I have listened to classical music on car rides, on train journeys. And I don't know, perhaps, of course, I'm biased. Of course, I am. but my husband, who is not really into classical music so much from his childhood, he says that when they listen to classical music, you don't get bored of it. But any other music after 1 hour or 2 hours, there is a certain monotony that creeps in. Of course, this could be his opinion, but certainly there is a freshness, there is something to always look forward, rediscover about classical music. The other day, Ranjani's mother-in-law, she was telling me about how, you know, her mother-in-law was sitting in a room and you know, for some time she didn't seem to be around and you went to see her.
Yes, I was looking for her. I wanted to talk to her about something and I opened the door and there she is, completely immersed in music. She was singing, she was trying out different sangatis and she was singing a raga, alapna. And I was waiting patiently for 10 minutes. It was something about that scene was so touching and moving. It moved me.
So it's a companion for life. Yes. And it's a companion who will be always there for you, who will inspire you, who will make you feel great, who will recharge your batteries. It and who will never let you slide into despondency.
Yes. And whatever age you are, you may be even, you know, hard of hearing. Your sight may dim a bit, but still.
The music inside you. Much. Once the music is inside you, it just lights up and recharges all your tired cells. And that's why classical music. And I'm sure the other musicians, other rasikas would have their own experiences and reasons and inspirations and motivations to share as to why you listen to classical music.
That brings us to another question related with this. There was one question saying that I am 17-year-old girl. Music bug bit me very late. Is it too late now to start learning music? Because she has heard many stories saying that most musicians have been introduced to music or they have been exposed from the age of 3 and they have been training.
Yeah, she was actually saying, does everyone have to be like 3 or 4 years to learn classical music?
Or do they have to be born in a musically immersed family?
Yeah, so what if music is a bug that bit me too late? What if I'm 18? What if I'm 25? What if I'm 30? How do I catch up? Is there a hope for me? Can I be good at this? So this is a very beautiful question. What do you think?
Well, I think that there is no age for learning. If learning is what you want to do and you enjoy what you do, the whole journey of music, go for it. There is no age limit to it. I know, Gayatri, 65-year-old mama used to learn violin along with us.
Oh, yeah. He was 65 and I was 7 years and he learned alongside me. And mama used to be so sincere and come every day. And you know, that was his post-retirement plan. He sat in the violin class and learned. Our father learned violin when he was in his 20s. Of course, he gave up the violin in his 30s when he saw that his daughters were getting ahead of him. But that's a different thing. And he chose to devote his time for us. But music is not like something that you have to get into it with a certain goal in mind, that you have to excel and by this age you have to tick all these boxes. It's not like that. It is just something that you do joyously and for life, as long as you continue to breathe, to live and enjoy life, you can engage with music.
Yes, and the only requirement that is necessary is open mind and desire to learn.
And I guess why people start early or why parents motivate their children is that as a child, why does a child learn so many things so quickly, be it learning to walk or to run or languages? It's because the child has an uncluttered, innocent mind and we are not asking questions or judging anything or bringing our complexes that an adult
No inhibitions has. Whatsoever.
So it makes learning very joyous, very easy. And if a teenager or an adult can bring to learning that sense of innocence, that's it. You can learn at any age because that's what it takes. A willing heart, a passionate mind and willingness to work hard at it. You know, from the time we started the Candids, some of the comments and questions that have been coming in, it has given us such a beautiful opportunity to actually think, to discuss, to gain clarity and to understand more deeply what, how, why.
Yes, and so please keep your comments coming.
Yes, and thank you for inspiring us and motivating us to talk about these things, to think about these things. This is as much a learning for us as anyone else.
So thank you for joining us this session.